Good morning, my dear students. Today we are going to start the another practical. It is called the examination, clinical examination of motor nervous system. As you have seen, we examine the sensory nervous system. We examine the components of the sensory nervous system, which we called the receptor, afferent nerve, ascending tract, and then the parietal lobe. Similarly, the motor nervous system we are going to examine. So we are going to examine the components of the nervous system. We have to assess functioning of the various components of the system. So motor nervous system is the nervous system, that is the body organs, the parts which are related to the movement are called the motor system. We call it as the motor system. Related to the movements, we call it system. So the nervous part of the nervous system which is concerned executing the movements related to the body function is called as motor nervous system. The components, it's an a descending system, like unlike in the case of sensory system, afferent system is called as the efferent system or descending system. It starts from the cerebral cortex. We have the motor cortex, the is the central sulcus. Behind the sulcus we call it as the sensory, primary sensory area. In front of that we call it as the motor, which is located in the front of primary motor area, and then the area and the supplementary motor area. And added to this we have the another components in the brain, which you call it as this subcortical structures like the basal ganglia and the cerebellum. These are also components of the motor system. From there the sense are carried to the pyramidal tracts. They descend in the spinal cord and over the, that is, we know that according to the Bell medulla, the ventral horn is the motor neurons present in the ventral horn. The horn contains the sensory neurons. So the motor neurons are present in the ventral horn. So the descends like pyramidal index, they end over the neurons present, which you call the anterior horn. So the anterior horn cells, which are the motor neurons, which end over there, they sign up there. From there, the anterior horn cells, the spinal nerves, the peripheral nerves, and reach the effector organ called the. So these muscles, according to the movement, we call them as, they are divided into two groups, which we call as the proximal and distal. That is, proximal muscles means which are present near to the girdle, near to the body. So near to the girdle, the third group of muscles, which you call called the foramen and the large muscles present in the lower limb and large muscles present in the upper limb, these are called the proximal muscles, which are concerned with the part and function called the posture and equilibrium. So if you want to execute any movement, a background of a stream is required. For example, imagine, you imagine a batsman in the cricket, playing a cricket, or the bowler playing the cricket. You see the various, that is, a batsman's posture is different and a bowler posture is different, but he has to maintain balance in that posture, then only he can deliver the goods. Similarly, here for writing something over the blackboard, or throwing a stone, or writing something like this. So we have various movements or motor functions for which you require a posture, and in that posture you have to maintain the balance, which you call the equilibrium. Whether you are standing on the two legs or single leg or side, in a single leg, all whatever you are standing, so you have to maintain the balance in that posture, bending or standing or sitting, whatever it may be. So that function is done by the proximal muscles, which are also called as the medial muscles. And the other group of muscles called as the distal muscles, which are present in the hands or in the toes. So these are concerned with the very skillful movements. For example, you are drawing something or writing something, for which you require the skill, the small muscles present in the hands. So these are called as the distal muscles, which are called required for the skillful movement. So for execution of a skillful movement, you require a posture and a balance. So medial muscles concerned with the posture and equilibrium, and the distal muscles also can be called as the lateral muscles. They are concerned with the skilled movements. So this is the components of the motor nervous system, which you are examining in stage wise or step wise. So the motor system is examined under the following headings. So first you will be examining the bulk of the muscle, then we will be examining the tone of the muscle and strength of the muscle or power of the muscle, coordination, and any involuntary muscles and reflexes. So the headings under which the examine. So first we will be examining the bulk of the muscle. We will be assessing the nutrition, that is the effector organ, the motor nervous system of the muscle. So the nutrition of the muscle can be assessed by examining the bulk of the muscle. The bulk of the muscle. So for that we have to make the subject sit comfortably or lie down. So as in any clinical examination, you have to remove the cloths and then you can assess the bulk of the muscle throughout the whole body by inspection. So the you can remove the cloth and you can assess the muscles. And for example, say the right and left part should have the equal size of the bulk, size of the muscle should be assessed by inspection. Then you can examine it by palpation. So palpation, the bulk of the muscle, for example, say the forearm muscles, for example. So you create the muscle on the right side and left side and you can compare. So the muscles, they are atrophied, then the muscle on palpation will be softer than the normal muscle. So normal muscle will have some turgor or tension in the muscle, will be lost, and that is a motor neuron type of paralysis. The bulk of the muscle will be decreased, thin, will be thin and softer. But in the case, for example, the poliomyelitis is the lower motor neuron type of disease, where so it's a element tension, so the atrophy will be seen, but there the will be replaced by the fibrosis. Fibrous tissue will be replacing the muscle, then they are inelastic and tough on palpation. Otherwise, in other types, muscle will be softer and thinner when there is a atrophy of the muscle. So inspection, you can assess by inspection the grass differ the bulk of the muscle. For example, cachexia, generalized wasting is there. So in that case, you can see that the thin skin and bones will be seen. So there you can have generalized atrophy of the muscle, whole body cachexic. Whereas in lower motor neuron type of lesion, so where we'll be seeing the atrophy on only in that group of the muscles. So like I told you, the motor components. So the other group can be classified, like I told you, medial and lateral group of muscles. Likewise, the motor neuron system can be classified as upper motor neuron and lower motor neuron. So from the brain up to the level of the antehan cell, it is called the upper motor neuron. So motor area, cerebellum, basal ganglia, and then the pyramidal, extrapyramidal tracts, up to the antehan cell, they are called the upper motor neuron. And from the antehan cell, the efferent nerve up to the skeletal muscle, the neuromuscular junction, it is called as the lower motor neuron. So if any there is a lesion from the antehan to the muscle, you call it the lower motor paralysis. If there is any lesion from the motor area up to the antehan, you call it the upper motor neuron type of lesion. So in the lower motor neuron type of lesion, the bulk of muscle is decreased, we call it as the atrophy. So generally, throughout the body, you can assess the bulk of the muscle increase. For example, you are going to an exercise or gym, then your body muscles will be increased throughout your body, which you call it the hypertrophy of the muscle. And some disease like Duchenne's muscular dystrophy, where there is a pseudo hypertrophy in some muscles like calf muscles and the thigh muscles and the back muscles, like that we have the pseudo hypertrophy. Only will be enlarged in size, hypertrophied, bigger than normal. But best way of assessing the bulk of the muscle is by measurement, the girth of the muscle. So usually a common denotation is, whenever you are measuring the bulk of the muscle, it should be measured in the upper limb around the elbow and in the lower limb around the knee joint. It is called as, you measure around the elbow in the upper limb, around the knee joint in the lower limb. Then next, coming to the another point, that is whenever you are measuring the girth of the muscle in upper limb, in the upper arm, so you have to take one fixed point, any bony reference point you have to take. That you have to measure where the girth is. You are expecting the girth to be maximum girth you are expecting. After that, you measure a fixed distance from the fixed bony point. The same distance, same length should be taken on the opposite limb also. Then you have to measure the girth of the muscle. For example, you take, so I will show you. So in the upper limb, you take a, for example, I told you in the beginning, you take a around the elbow. For example, if I take the elbow, take a bony prominence. distance that is the Olecranon process from that, a certain distance, some centimeters. For example, you take 16 centimeters, you measure 16 centimeters, and at that level, you measure the depth of the muscle, the upper arm. After measurement, you measure the depth as around, for example, here it is the 30 centimeters. Similarly, on the other side, you take the like Olecranon process, you measure, earlier you have taken the point as 16 centimeters. Similarly, you take the 16 centimeters and measure the gut of the muscles in the upper arm. It is around 29 centimeters. So, approximately equal. So, the depth of the muscle on right and left are almost same. So, when you measure, you observe just a slight as a 1 centimeter difference. Maybe. So, we are all right-handed persons. So, we will be using the right hand more than the left hand. So, we will be, our muscles will be slightly hypertrophied on the right hand, the left side. That is why probably here it is the 30 centimeters, here it is the 29 centimeters. Likewise, the forearm also, you take from the Olecranon process, measure around the elbow. You don't go down. If you are going down, you are the only tendon person. The bulk of muscle will be less. So you see where the bulk of the muscle move around the elbow. So that means from in the arm, from here to measure in the arm, in the mid arm circumference. Similarly, in the forearm, don't take the mid forearm. Maybe the less. So take the upper 1/3 with the 2/3 of the forearm, the junction, and 2/3 of the forearm, you take the junction. So measure some, for example, around 11 centimeters, then measure the girth here. It is around 25 centimeters. And also measure from the Olecranon process. So the equidistance, same as you take, and then the depth, it is same, around 25 centimeters. Bulk of the muscles in the upper limb. Similarly, in the lower limb also, you take any bony prominence in the knee joint, measure from that bony prominence the mid circumference, and then immediately compare on the opposite side also, same distance you take and depth of the thigh muscle you measure. Similarly, so in the lower side, around the calf, take the bony point, from the bony point, measure the fixed distance, like this. Similarly, from the bony prominent, from the knee joint, measure on either side. Likewise, you measure the bulk of the muscle for the assessing the nutrition, and then the in which way it is useful is you can diagnose the disease, that is paralysis. So the lesions of the nervous system, autonomic system, you call it the paralysis, or slight weakness we call it the paresis. So if it is a paralysis, you can diagnose whether it is a lower motor neuron type of paralysis or upper motor neuron type of paralysis by the bulk of the muscle itself. So in the lower motor neuron type example, which you called the poliomyelitis, we will see the atrophy, muscular atrophy on the affected group of the muscles. Next heading is the tone of the muscle. So we have to examine the tone of the muscle. So tone is defined as a state of partial tetanic contraction due to asynchronous discharge of gamma motor neuron. So you have seen that the alpha motor neuron supplying to the external muscle fiber, and then the gamma motor neuron, and then the beta. So gamma motor neuron supplying to the intrafusal muscle fiber, and beta supplying both extra and intrafusal. You have seen, you are all knowing that. So that gamma motor neuron will not have a synchronous asynchronous discharge from the higher center, the motor neurons or the motor areas, the basal ganglia, cerebellum, all these they discharge you. the alpha motor neuron, you call it as the final common pathway, because all the signals reach the alpha motor neuron from various components, and from the alpha motor neuron signal reach the final effector organ muscle. So it is called the common final pathway. Similarly, the gamma motor neuron, they will be discharged, they will be sending signals to the intrafusal muscle fiber. Through the intrafusal fiber, well, no, that is, you have seen the stretch reflex, you have seen the muscle spindle is the receptor for the stretch reflex, you have seen. So that intrafusal muscle fiber is supplied by the gamma motor neuron, and it also causes the indirect way, it is a gamma alpha co-linkage, indirect way it causes, the also stimulates the alpha motor neuron. Through the alpha motor neuron, it can also cause the contract shortening of the muscle fiber. But that gamma motor neuron will be asynchronously discharging, which causes a partial, not a complete tetanic contraction, a partial state of tetanic contraction, which produces some amount of tension or in the muscle, which you call it as the tone of the muscle. That is a theoretical definition. Clinical definition, clinically, how do you call the tone of the muscle? Is the tone of muscle is clinically called as the resistance offered to the passive stretching of the muscle or passive movement across the various joints. If you produce a passive, active means on your own, if you are doing that, it is called as the active movement. So you relax, somebody is doing instead of you, somebody is moving your limb, that is called as the passive movement. So when you are doing the passive movement across the various joints in your body, the muscles offer a state of some amount of resistance, that is clinically called as the tone of the muscle. So you have to examine throughout the body the various, across various joints, and then you have to assess the resistance offered by the muscles. For example, in the upper limb, for example, you take the elbow joint. So as expected to completely relax, they should completely relax, and you should put the limb. You will not be holding. Suppose if you are doing, the limb should fall down like this. So that means that if they are not actively or passive. So, for example, you take, that is, always see the muscle, expose the muscle, hold the limb, and then so they should be relaxed, and you have to. When you are, for example, I am flexing, the stretch, the tricep muscle is stretched. When you are doing the flexion passively, the tricep muscle is stretched. You will feel the tricep becoming tense in your hands here. You are keeping a hand here. So when you are flexing the limb like this, the tricep becomes tense in your hand. That is the way you assess the tension in the tricep. Similarly, you hold the arm like this. When you are flexing the biceps, when you are extending, the biceps becomes tense underneath your fingers. That's how you assess the tone of the. So during extension, you assess the tone of the biceps muscle. During flexion, you assess the biceps tone of the biceps muscle. So like this, you can examine, and similarly in the opposite limb. So you can passively hold the limb, hold your upper arm with the hand, and with the other hand you hold this one, and you passively, the subject is not actively moving, you are moving. So when you flex, feel the biceps. When you extend, feel the biceps. So likewise, in the lower limb also, you can do the movement across the back. You can hold the knee joint, and then do the flexion and extension, and we examine the tone of the muscle in the lower limb also. So tone, by experience you will be assessing what is the normal resistance offered, what is the abnormal. So if you go on examining this, you will be knowing what is the normal tension. So this tone tension in the muscle, how does it come? When you are born, all of your muscles, that's why when you touch the newborn baby, the baby body will be very flabby, soft to touch. As you grow, more lengthier than the muscles. But with these muscles are attached to your tendons, to your bones, as the bulging more, they are lengthier than the muscle fibers. The muscle fiber inherently is stretched. Even when you are sleeping or lying down or sleeping, although muscles are kept always under a stretch. This stretch stimulates your muscle spindle, produces this asynchronous discharge of the gamma motor neuron, causes some amount of resistance. No, that's why even if you are resting and not doing any exercise also, you can, when you expose the body, you can see the shape of the delta, shape of the biceps. An exercised body, well, they are well seen. Even in an unexercised body also, you can see the shape of the muscle, you can see the biceps, because they are under stretch, so that is the tone of the muscle. So this tone will be decreased, we call it the hypotone, and tone will be increased, which you call it the hypertonia. So in the some clinical conditions, for example, again, you can diagnose Ullmann lesion. In Ullmann lesion, you will see the hypotension in the muscles or hypotonia, and Ullmann lesion, muscles will be increased, which is called as the hypertonia. The integrity of this depends upon the tone of the muscle, depends upon the reflex R. You all know the components of the reflex R. So, reflex R, the receptor, the afferent nerve, the center, the nerve, the effector are. So, any lesion in this component causes the loss of the reflex. So, whenever there is a lesion in the afferent limb, afferent nerve, or efferent nerve, or efferent limb, or in the alpha motor neuron, which you call that the lower motor neuron type of paralysis. Like again, I told the example of meniscus where you will see yes, so we call it the hypotonia. This tension will be sometimes physiological examples also like the anxiety. So the gamma, like in the theory you might have heard, the gamma motor discharge is increased, the sensitivity is gamma motor neuron is increased in conditions like the anxiety, in hyperthyroidism. So you have seen the in the such theoretical aspects of the hypertonia. Similarly, the upper motor neuron lesion, so the tension is increased. So the reason for this is, later I will tell you when about the reflexes. When you discuss about the reflexes examination, we will discuss about the why the tension hypertonia in the upper motor neuron lesion is seen. So next, move on to the other days, we examined the bulk of the muscle and we can diagnose the Ullmann lesion or Ullmann lesion. We examined the tone of the muscle, we can diagnose the Ullmann or Ullmann lesion. Next, move on to the strength of the muscle or power of the muscle. So this, like you have seen the tone of the muscle examined during a passive movement. So this act, the strength of the muscle or power muscle is determined during the active movement. So when the person is actively moving, you offer some amount of resistance and you assess the strength of the power of the muscle. For example, you ask the subject to flex the arm, so you add the resistance to the flexion of the arm, then you ask them to use the flexion, assess the strength power of the muscle. So likewise, you examine the strength or power of muscle in the whole body, so in the upper limb and lower limb. So this power of muscle on examination, you clinically are in the examination, you will be assessing it, the grading it, you will be seeing the or assessing the strength of the muscle. So this grade 0 means complete paralysis, the muscle is paralyzed, not at all, no movement at all. So there is no movement at all of muscle, there is no movement of the muscle, that is called the grade 0, complete paralysis. Grade 1, so when you ask the person to move the limb or the muscle, then the, he is unable to move, but still there is a some amount when he is willing to try to move, there is a flicker of contraction in the muscle. That is called the grade 1. Grade 2, so he is able to move the limb when the force acting against it, that is the gravity force, is excluded, then there is a movement in the muscle. That is called as the grade 2. You exclude the gravity, then there will be a movement of the muscle. So for example, is it, there is no movement at all in the muscle. When I ask them to move, and there is no grade 0. When I ask them to raise some, so So eroding, suppose I ask him to move this limb, flexion or extension or an adduction, they are trying to move, so against gravity. So against gravity he cannot do the movement. Excluding, how you exclude? That is, his limb is lying here, so you are avoiding the gravity. Then the movement is possible only this way or that way. They can move this limb like this. So I ask him to move, then the subject will be moving this way or that way. This is how it is called as the exclusion of the gravity. That is gravity. So I ask him to move now. Against the gravity is possible. He can lift the limb against the gravity. But if I offer resistance, there is no movement. He cannot lift. Suppose I say like this and ask him to move, he cannot lift. So against gravity there is a movement possible, but against resistance there is no movement. Grade 3. Grade 4, I ask him to move, so there is movement, but I can overcome it. There is a against resistance, so subject is able to flex, but if I use force, I can overcome the movement. That is called, that is, there is a visual some amount of weakness in the muscle. That is called the grade 4. Grade 5, if I ask to, so if I offer resistance, it is able to flex. The grade is normal. 5, grade 5. So like this, you are grading the power of the muscle. Grade 0, paralysis. Complete, there is no movement at all. Grade 1, flicker of movement. Grade 2, exclusion of gravity, there is a movement. Grade 3, against gravity is possible but not impossible against the resistance. Grade 4, also there is a movement but the examiner can overcome the resistance. Grade 5, normal. The subject can overcome the resistance offered by the examiner. He can do the complete normal. That is a normal power of the muscle. We will be grading the muscles. So, first you start from the small muscles or intrinsic muscles of the hand. For example, we will be examining the thumb muscle. So first is, so the abductor is, so you ask the subject to move the thumb in parallel to the index finger like this, and you offer the resistance. So you can see the thenar muscle here becoming the prominent. This is how you examine the abductor pulsis. The abductor muscle becoming tense, you can observe, and he is able to do this abduction against my resistance. And similarly, the first dorsal intrastriate, so its movement is abduction, moving away from the center. So you offer resistance, the subject is able to abduct the index finger. This is how you examine the first dorsal intrastriate. Other dorsal intrastriate also, you offer resistance, abduction is done. So like this, we are examining the intrastriate. So palmar intrastriate, so they are adductors. They are adductors. In between the fingers, ask the subject to hold and try to put. So they are adducting, closing this card, and it's impossible to pull away the paper or card from the in between the fingers. So we examine the palmar intrastriate. Next, flexors. So flexors are the fingers. You give your index and the middle finger, ask the subject to. So all this exam, that is like this abductor pulsis. Next is the opponent's pulsis, so the thumb mechanism. You hold the fingers. Otherwise, this finger may come and touch the thumb. So prevent that. To prevent this, you hold like this. Ask the subject to touch the thumb, the middle finger. This is how you examine the opponents. Similarly, you can examine the muscles from the opposite limb. So abductor pulsis, and then the abductors, and then the adductors. So you can examine. Still, next you examine the, so you have examined all the intrinsic muscles, dorsal intertia and palmar intertia, you have examined. Next,
we are going to examine the lumbricals, the hand. So their action is flexion at metacarpopharyngeal joint and extension at the phalanges. So this action can be examined by asking the subject to hold a pen. So flexion at the metacarpals and metacarpophalangeal and the extension at the phalangeal. And try to dislodge the pen. So the power is examined. So it's unable to dislodge the pen. Likewise, each finger can be examined. Each finger and lumbricals can be examined. And along with this, we are also examining the opponent's pollicis. So because you are holding this, so along with this lumbrical, we are also examining the opponent's pollicis. So when they are holding, these two muscles are using. So similarly, you can use this other hand for the examination of the lumbricals and you try to dislodge. So here also we are examining the both the opponent's pollicis and as well as the lumbricals.
The flexors. So flexors from the forearms applied to the fingers, you examine the flexion of the fingers. So like I shown you, whenever you examine anything on this side, you have to immediately next followed by other side to compare. So compare with the subject. So you are, when you are comparing the power of the strength of the muscle with the examiner, the subject and examiner, you are comparing, you should compare the age, sex, and then the build also. For example, the subject is heavily built, then you cannot offer the resistance. Power will be greater. Like that you have assessed. Similarly, you have to compare right side with the other, left side. When you examine the flexors of the fingers simultaneously, you can give your two fingers, ask the subject to squeeze your two fingers simultaneously and try to pull. So it is not coming. So this we examine the power of the flexors. Next we examine that the wrist joint. So you examine the flexors and extensors of the to hold the fist and then you offer and ask him to do flexion like this. So against resistance, so ask the subject to hold the fist like this with your hand, offer resistance and ask him to flex. So it is almost impossible to prevent the flexion. So it's so powerful. On the other side also, you examine, so ask him to flex. So almost impossible to prevent the flexion. Similarly, you examine the extension. Ask the subject to hold the fist and then keep your hand and ask him to extend. Again, it's impossible. Similarly, so extension, flexion and extension at the wrist joint. Next, similarly, ask the subject to hold the in semi-prone or semi-supine position, hold the hand like this, ask the person to do the flexion. So now you can see the standing up of the brachioradialis muscle and the resistance. So this is a brachioradialis, how you examine. Similarly, hold. So you can see the brachioradialis standing up and contracting. So like that, you examine the brachioradialis. Next, we examine the at the elbow. So you have to examine the biceps and triceps. So ask the subject, the biceps, the action is ask the subject to actively do flexion and you have the resistance. So also the contraction of the biceps muscle and the resistance fight normal. So also ask the subject to flexion and for resistance. The biceps and it is almost impossible to prevent the flexion. Clearly, at the subject to hold like this, the biceps extend to offer resistance. So you can observe that biceps become tense and you are prevent the extension. Similarly, on the opposite side, palpate the triceps and the resistance. likewise, you examine the forearm muscle. Next, at the shoulder, you can examine the supraspinatus and deltoid simultaneously. Ask the subject to abduct the upper arm up to the 90 degrees right angle, like this. Correct. So you can see up to this is the up to 30 degrees is the supraspinatus, then up to this is the deltoid muscle. You can offer the resistance like this and ask the sitting arm up to the 90 degrees. You examine on the side also like this. So you can see the seated part by the supraspinatus. Next is the middle fibers of the deltoid. Then after holding the right angles on the palm and backward movement is by the anterior and posterior fibers of the deltoid. You can offer resistance like this as the subject to move, and similarly on the opposite side also at right angles you can offer resistance. So forward movement and backward movement. So that's how you examine the deltoid muscles. So we examine the bulk of the muscle, the tone of the muscle, the power of the muscle. Next we are going to examine the reflexes. So reflexes theory, you are all know the reflexes. The definition of the reflex, it is a involuntary, inborn, automatic motor response to a sensory stimulus, and they are classified as the monosynaptic and polysynaptic. And monosynaptic, the best examples are the tendon jerks or deep reflexes, and polysynaptic is the superficial reflexes. So clinically we are examining the monosynaptic and polysynaptic by way of examining the deep reflexes and superficial reflexes. So clinical example or classification of the reflexes is superficial reflexes, deep reflexes and visceral reflexes. So here we are going to examine the deep reflexes and superficial reflexes. So deep reflexes are the tendon jerks. So we start with the upper limb and proceed to the lower limb. So these reflexes are examined by using an instrument here, which is called the knee hammer. So this knee hammer should be shown to the subject and should explain it does not cause any harm to the subject. You are going to use this, but you are not going to harm the subject. They should be explained, and subject should be sitting in a calm posture, because reflexes, they can be elicited best when they are very relaxed, then only you can elicit. Next is, you have to expose the muscle on which you are going to demonstrate the reflex. For example, if I am doing the bicep jerk, you have to see the muscle at the biceps. If you are doing the tricep jerk, you have to see the triceps muscle. If you are doing the supinator jerk, you have to see the brachioradialis. If you are able, you are going to see the knee jerk, demonstrate the knee jerk, you have to see the quadriceps muscle. If you are doing the ankle jerk, you have to see the calf muscle. Like that, the muscle should be exposed, because the muscles will be contracting. So that contraction should be visible. Usually you expect the contraction of the muscle producing some movement. So if the movement is not possible, at least the contraction of the muscle we should see. Like this, we have examined all the limbs from the intrinsic muscles to the wrist, the forearm, the upper shoulder muscles we have examined. And when you are ఇది ఇన్ఫ్రా అది సెరటస్ ఏమో అది. సో ఆఫ్టర్ ది సూప్రాస్పైనటస్ అండ్ డెల్టాయిడ్ ఎగ్జామిన్ ది ఇన్ఫ్రాస్పైనటస్. సో ఇన్ఫ్రాస్పైనటస్ ఈజ్ ఎగ్జామిన్ ద ఫోర్ మైండ్ ఈస్ టక్డ్ ఇన్ టు ద బాడీ అండ్ ద మూమెంట్ ఫ్రమ్ అవే మూమెంట్ షుడ్ బి ప్రివెంటెడ్ బై ఆఫరింగ్ ఏ రెసిస్టెన్స్. దెన్ ది ఇన్ఫ్రాస్పైనటస్ మజిల్ కెన్ బి సీన్ ఆన్ ద బిహైండ్ ఆర్ పాల్పేటెడ్ లైక్ దిస్. అండ్ సిమిలర్లీ, so the infraspinatus flexion, working into the body and then movement, this movement away, which you call the abduction, should be prevented by offering the resistance. And you examine the infraspinatus. Next, we examine the serratus anterior muscle. So, the serratus anterior muscle is examined by asking the subject to pushing the wall. So, when they push the wall, the serratus anterior muscle, they become tense or contracted. When it is paralyzed, the scapula will be shown prominently, which is called the ringing of the scapula. So, we examined all the muscles in the upper limb. Next, we move on to the muscles present in the trunk or abdomen. So, the subject should be lying down. We will be examining the pectoral muscles. Pectoral muscles are examined by asking the subject to keep the arms like this and trying to clap, and we have to prevent this by offering the resistance. And you can observe the pectoral muscles becoming prominent, and you can see the resistance offered by the pectoral muscles. Latissimus muscle dorsi. So, as the person to grasp the and then you offer the resistance to the downward and backward movement. So, like this, you offer the resistance to the downward and backward movement, and the latissimus dorsi cover is examined. Or you can feel or palpate the posterior fold of the axilla becoming prominent when you offer resistance to the downward and backward movement. So, the subject is clasping the hands behind, and you offer resistance to the downward and backward movement, and the latissimus dorsi becoming prominent. Abdominal muscles. So, abdominal muscles in general, they can be examined by asking the subject first to ask them to lie on the supine posture, ask the subject to sit up without using the support of the hands. That's how we examine the abdominal muscles. Without using the support from the hands, they have to down from the supine posture. So, like that, you examine the abdominal muscles. Paralysis or hemiplegia, when the subject tries to do like this, on the paralysis side, the heel will be lifted off from the couch like this. This is called as the Babinski's rising up sign. So, to diagnose the cases of the hemiplegia. Another examination for the abdominal muscle is down and offer the resistance to lifting up from the supine posture to be lifted up actively. We do like that, and you offer resistance by keeping your hand over the head and offer the resistance. So, if that is doing, you observe the muscle becoming tight, and also the umbilicus. You observe the umbilicus like this. You can palpate the muscles becoming tight and the umbilicus does not move. For example, suppose if there is a paralysis of the upper quadrant of the abdominal muscles, the umbilicus will move downwards, and when there is a lower, the abdominal muscles are weak, the umbilicus will move upwards. This is called as the Beaver's sign. Similarly, you can examine the back muscles, the erector spinae and back muscles, by asking the subject to lie down on the prone position. position, prone position, asking to lift the head up. So like this, and after this, you can see the erector spinae and this neck muscles, the back muscles, they're becoming tight. Muscles of the lower limb. You start from the feet. So the feet, the you will examine from the feet, toes and the feet. So the intrinsic muscles are examining the flexion and extension and assessing the power of the muscle of the knee. So as the subject to flex like this. So extension chain. So now you keep your hand over the shin, ask the subject to extend and you offer resistance, extension. So like this, it is impossible to prevent the extension. Similarly, flexion of the knee joint. So you ask the subject to keep in this semi-flexible position, keep your hand here, ask the subject to flex knee joint like this. You offer resistance. This is a grade 5. Similarly, in the other side also, at the flexed position, keep your hand over the shin, ask the subject to extension and examining the power of the extension. Similarly, flex also the knee. Keep your hand and ask the subject to flex. You offer resistance. This is the grade 5 at the knee joint. Next, we will be examining at the hip, that is the thigh muscle. So, thigh extension and flexion. Without flexing at the knee joint, keep the lower limb straight. Ask the subject to lift the limb above the couch or the above the bed and offer the resistance. So, this mirror cut. So, this equals the subject to lift the lip like this, keep your hand kindik nokkandi sir. So this is the extension at the joint and try to prevent, and unable to prevent the extension. Similarly, in the opposite keep your hand as the subject to extension and the limb is extended at the hip joint. Similarly, flexion at the hip joint. Either they can lift the limb straight above like this or they can slightly flex and from this position flex at the joint. Either way you can so flexion at, so without any flexion at the knee joint, now the subject will be flexing at the hip. Earlier you examined the extension at the hip, now we are examining the flexion. Offer the resistance. So you are offering resistance here, there is the flexion at the hip joint. Similarly, on the opposite side also, you are offering resistance, flexion is possible at the hip joint. So flexion and extension at the hip joint. Next, at the hip joint, the other movements are abduction and adduction. Abduction and adduction possible at the hip joint. So with this, so both in the center, is moved away from the body, that is called as the abduction. Towards the body is called as the adduction, and you offer resistance. So you offer resistance, and the limb is moved away, called as the abduction. Similarly, you offer. So this is in the center. I offer resistance. The leg is moved away. This is called as the abduction. Resistance, the limb is moving away. This is called as the abduction. So, the abduction from away towards the center. So, I offer resistance, the limb is moving towards the center. This is called as the abduction. Similarly, on the side also, I am offering resistance, the leg is moving towards the center. This is called as the abduction. And at the hip joint, another thing is rotation is possible like this. So, the leg is without moving any way, so it is slightly rotated this way and that way. So that can also be examined. The hip, you have the resistance, and the foot is rotated. So the leg is rotated, similarly rotated this way at the hip joint. In the opposite leg also rotated inward. Examine the power of the muscle in the upper limb, the chest, pectoral and backside latissimus dorsi, and some other muscles in the neck muscles, we call the trapezius and sternocleidomastoid. They will be examined when you are examining the cranial nerves. So abdominal muscles we have seen, the back muscles we have examined the strength, and the strength of the muscles in the lower limb we have examined. So we examined the bulk of the muscle, the tone of the muscle, the power of the muscle. Next we are going to examine the reflexes. So reflexes, theory you are all know, the reflexes, the definition of the reflex, it is a involuntary, inborn, automatic motor response to a sensory stimulus, and they are classified as the monosynaptic and polysynaptic. And monosynaptic, the best examples are the tendangex or deep reflexes, and polysynaptic is the superficial reflexes. So clinically we are examining the monosynaptic and polysynaptic by way of examining the deep reflexes and superficial reflexes. So clinical example or classification of the reflexes is superficial reflexes, deep reflexes and visceral reflexes. So here we are going to examine the deep reflexes and superficial reflexes. So deep reflexes are the tendangex. So we start with the upper limb and proceed to the lower limb. So these reflexes are examined by using an instrument here, which is called the knee hammer. So this knee hammer should be shown to the subject and should explain it does not cause any harm to the subject. You are going to use this, but you are not going to harm the subject. They should be explained, and subject should be in a sitting in a calm posture, because reflexes, they can be elicited best when they are very relaxed, then only you can elicit. Next is, you have to expose the muscle which on which you are going to demonstrate the reflex. For example, if I am doing the biceps jerk, you have to see the muscle at the biceps. If you are doing the triceps jerk, you have to see the triceps muscle. If you are doing the supinator jerk, you have to see the brachioradialis. If you are able, you are going to see the knee jerk, demonstrate the knee jerk, you have to see the quadriceps muscle. If you are doing the ankle jerk, you have to see the calf muscle. Like that, the muscle should be exposed, because the muscles will be contracting. So that contraction should be visible. Usually you expect the contraction of the muscle producing some movement. So if the movement is not possible, at least the contraction of the muscle we should see. Using the knee hammer, we are going to tap over the tendon so that the muscle is stretched and stretch reflex is initiated. So when you are using the knee hammer, so the knee hammer should be held like this, and then the movement, when you should not, so the knee hammer should fall on its own by weight like this. You should only support or control or manipulate it. You should not hit it using this. So you have to just manipulate it or control the fall of the knee hammer from above like this. So lift it and allow it to fall like this. So when you are holding like this, you have to allow, and the movement should be at the wrist joint only. You should not use your elbow to hit it like this. So you should hold the knee hammer like this, and the movement should be only at the wrist. You have to lift the knee hammer, allow it to fall like this. So like this, the knee hammer should be used. So start with, we are going to examine the biceps jerk. So the biceps jerk is examined holding the hand in a semi-flexor position like this, and then supporting, exposing the biceps muscle and supporting the limb, and over the biceps tendon, you have to keep your thumb, and the knee hammer should fall on your thumb so that when it hits, and there will be a stretch of the biceps tendon, the muscle will be stretched and stress reflex is initiated. So you can see, if you are careful, you should have observed the muscle contracting. So the biceps muscle is contracting. Well visible here. You can see actually the biceps muscle is contracting when I am tapping here. So and the bicep jerk is of a greater grade, the flexion will be seen here at this arm like this. Similarly, on the other side also, support the arm like this. So support for arm, keep your thumb pressing over the biceps tendon. The knee hammer should be lifted and allowed to fall. You can see the biceps jerk, flex at the elbow and contraction of the biceps muscle. So you have to compare the bicep jerk either side. This is the one way. The other way of doing that is with your hand you are supporting the biceps at the forearm and doing the bicep jerk. Second way is asking the subject to lie down and keeping the arm supported over the abdomen, and then you keep your, ask the subject to lie down supine. Is the triceps jerk. So we'll be working the forearm like this. Biceps belly is here, the tendons are here, they are broadly inserted. So you support support with the broad and the knee hammer. Muscle. I am supporting the forearm with the knee hammer. I am hitting the ulakantha support. The tendons are there, or the tendon will hit, then extension will be seen. The extension at the forearm and contraction at the belly of the triceps, like this. So you can see the extension. The tendons are inserted here, and with the knee hammer you tap over the biceps, triceps extension is seen. So the triceps muscle, biceps jerk, with the knee hammer hit over the tendon is seen at the forearm. Next is the supinator jerk or brachioradialis jerk. So keep the arm, forearm in the semi prone or supine position, and then slightly stretch at the wrist joint so that the supinator brachioradialis tendon is stretched over the radius bone. Take the knee hammer, allow it to fall over the tendon of the brachioradialis. Then the brachioradialis will be contracting, and then move them to supinator. So you stretch it like this and then allow the knee hammer to fall like this, and similarly on the opposite side also hold the hand like this, support it, relax it. So allow the knee hammer to fall. And then, so quadriceps muscle is exposed and the tendon, so patellar tendon. So you observe, first feel or palpate the tendon, stretch it with your finger like this, feel it on the other side also, stretch it, and then they are supported and they are free, relaxed, subject is freely relaxed and the muscle is not in a contracted state, they are in a relaxed state. Now take the knee hammer and tap over the patella tendon like this. So extension at the knee joint is seen, contraction at the quadriceps muscle is seen. So this is, you have palpated the patella tendon, this is the patella, the tubercle, in between you have the tendon, soft tendon. So you should not hit over the tubercle or over the patella, you have to hit over the, stretch over the patella tendon here. On the opposite side also, palpate the patella tendon and with knee hammer hit like this, extension of the knee joint is seen and the contraction of the quadriceps muscle is seen. Next is the ankle jerk. So this is the Achilles tendon, tendo-Achilles tendon, the foot is free and then slightly the ball is flexed so that the tendon is stretched. Calf muscle is and then you tap over the Achilles tendon, then the foot will be dorsiflexed like this. So this is the ankle jerk, one way of demonstrating like this. Next, similarly you can, so similarly the calf muscle is exposed, the Achilles tendon, the foot is relaxed. Hammer, allow it to fall over the Achilles tendon, there is a contraction of the calf muscle and flexion at the ankle. These reflexes which I demonstrated can be demonstrated in a lying or supine posture also. For example, you start with the biceps, so biceps can be demonstrated in the supine or lying posture also. So here we need not the support the limb, the limb will be supported by the subject itself. So it will be kept over the abdomen and it is supported. Now the biceps tendon is there. So palpate the biceps tendon, keep your thumb like this and then with a knee hammer it and the flexion is examined. Similarly, the limb is supported here and the tricep jerk can be demonstrated. So similarly, on the opposite, so bicep jerk, we demonstrate on the right side. Left side also similarly, so the limb is supported by keeping over the abdomen over the subject and then the biceps muscle is exposed, keep your thumb over the biceps tendon, fall like this and flexion at the elbow is seen. Similarly, you can examine the triceps muscle also. Keep the hand supported over the abdomen, triceps is exposed, tendon is hit with the knee hammer and the extension will be seen at the elbow like this. You can see the contraction of triceps and extension at the elbow. Compare this on the opposite side, similarly supported over the abdomen, triceps is exposed, seen. Seen, take the knee hammer, hit over the triceps, extension is seen, contraction of the triceps muscle is seen. Similarly, the brachioradialis, can be examined, supported over the abdomen, slightly stretched. Hit over the radius, this is the bone radius over which the tendon is passing, so knee hammer should fall over the tendon and then the supination is seen. Similarly, on the opposite side, the brachioradialis muscle or supinator, this is supinator jerk, it is called as the wrist, at the wrist it will be slightly bent so that the tendons are made prominent, allow the knee hammer to fall over the tendon and there is a supination is observed. Like this, in the lower limb also, the knee jerk in the lying posture, so we can support like this. So with your hand you can so you can support and slightly lift with your hand like this, keep this, the tendon is stretched, you can hit over the tendon and the knee will be extended like this, it will be demonstrated. Similarly, you can support this, about this, tendon is exposed, the foot is kept over the couch, limb is purely supported by your hand, and the tendon is stretched. Feel, palpate the tendon, don't touch the patella or tubercle, there are bony prominence, the pain, it's very painful. So palpate over the tendon, hit with a knee hammer over the tendon, and extension is seen. This is how you demonstrate the knee jerk. Then hold the foot like this so that the tendon is made prominent. Hit over the knee hammer, your hand will be pushed down by plantar flexion. So this is how the ankle jerk is demonstrated. Similarly, also slightly flex here, hold the foot by holding the great toe or the foot like this, make the tendon prominent, hit over the knee hammer, your hand will be pushed down. That's like this. This is the ankle jerk, with demonstration of the ankle jerk in the lying posture. So you demonstrate all the jerks in the lying posture also. These are the two ways of demonstrating the jerks in the sitting posture as well as the supine posture. Knee jerk can be demonstrated in other way also. Make the subject when you are sitting at the edge of couch, the couch is supporting your limb. Second, when lying posture, the examiner is supporting with the hand. Now the subject himself can support the knee joint like this, one knee kept at the other, so this knee is supported like this. They can sit and then feel the patella tendon and demonstrate the knee jerk with a knee hammer like this, and extension you are expecting. Suppose some condition that the patient is anxious or he is new to the system, new to the examination, so he may not get. Then what to do is, there is a maneuver called the gymnastics maneuver, so that there is a reinforcement. That is, the sensitivity of the gamma motor neuron is increased by reinforcing supraspinally. Suppose this is the knee jerk, is the center is L2, L3, L4. Above the spinal cord, above that level, in the spinal cord, you stimulate the alpha motor neuron. Then because of the alpha gamma co-linkage, the sensitivity of the gamma motor neuron in this center will be increased. So you will get the reflex. That is the basis for the gymnastics maneuver. For example, you have done demonstrate the knee jerk. Gymnastics maneuver means above that, you do some maneuver, actively stimulate the alpha motor neuron. Ask the subject, so if you are demonstrating the knee jerk like this, ask the subject, hold the hands like this and ask the subject to pull apart. And when they are doing like this, you ask the subject to pull the hands like this, you demonstrate the knee jerk. So in the earlier the knee jerk you are not getting, now you tap with the knee hammer, you will get the knee jerk. That is called as the gymnastic maneuver. Suppose you are not getting the biceps jerk, supraspinal, again this is 5-6, you say the 5-6, above that segment level, some movement, some active contraction you are expecting. For that, you ask the subject to clench the teeth. So the muscles here, the masseter muscles will be contracting actively, they will be clenching tightly. At that time, you do you support the limb. So as the subject, so when you are not getting the bicep jar, then you ask the subject to do the clenching of the teeth, then you hit with a knee hammer like this, then you get the bicep jar. This is called the reinforcement or sensitization of the gamma motor neuron, supraspinal reinforcement, or supraspinally sensitizing the gamma motor neuron discharge. This is about the deep reflexes. Deep reflexes. Next, we move on to the superficial reflexes. There is a list of superficial reflexes, like in the cranial nerve examination, we will be doing usually the carnial reflex, conjunctival reflex, pupillary right reflex, and in the coming down will be demonstrating the abdominal reflex, and third one will be demonstrating the plantar reflex. There are numerous reflexes which cannot be demonstrated. Only which thing can be demonstrated clinically, we are going to discuss them. So when you are going to discuss the cranial exam, nerve examination, we'll discuss the corneal, conjunctival and pupillary reflexes. Now we'll demonstrate only abdominal reflex and plantar reflex. So abdominal reflex demonstrated in the four quadrants. Betiki mantara parla da me gothi gikthane erraga ipindi meka. So we are going to examine the four quadrants of the abdomen. So always stimulate, that we are going to stimulate the skin superficially, that is the skin is stimulated, but you will be observing the muscles contracting beneath. So we will be examining in the four quadrants: above, right side and left side, below, again left side and right side. Always you stimulate from the periphery to the center, from away to the center, and observe the muscle contraction and movement of the umbilicus. When this quadrant of the muscle is contracting, the umbilicus is pulled towards the contraction. But if it is paralyzed, it will be pulled away. So by the other active muscle contracting. So it will be normally demonstrating the normal abdominal reflex. Four quadrants stimulated from the periphery to the center. So from away to the center, upper, where are the pointed stimulus like this, and from away to the center like this, and away to the center like this. You can observe the muscle contracting. You can observe the muscle, abdominal muscle contracting. Four quadrants we have examined the abdominal reflex. So like in the ankle jerk, you have demonstrated where you can at the knee joint, and that's slightly body reflex, and then foot is kept like this, and take a sharp blunt object like this, pointed blunt object. You have to stimulate the skin and the muscles will be contracting. That is the superficial or polysynaptic reflex. In the plantar reflex, you have to stimulate laterally in the foot. So from starting from the heel to up to the level of the little toe, you have to the single stroke, you have to stroke from the heel to the little toe, then curve towards the head toe. Like this you have to start here, up to the little toe, rest of the little toe, then curve towards the great toe. In a single stroke you have to give the stimulus and observe the reaction in the foot. So this is called a good plantar reflex. Like this you have to stimulate. Ungo sir. To stimulate. Similarly, in the opposite side also, you have to stimulate the heel to the little toe, base of the little toe, then curve towards the great toe. Like this you have to stimulate. So normal response in the plantar reflex is dorsiflexion at the ankle, plantar flexion and crowding of the all the toes. Dorsiflexion at the ankle and plantar flexion and crowding, or you can say that they are adducted. So like this, so plantar flexion of all the toes, that is the normal response. This abnormal. In abnormal conditions, abnormal response is seen, which is called as the Babinski sign. So earlier in abdomen I have told you Babinski rising up sign, but Babinski is very famous for this reflex or this sign, which is called as the Babinski sign and the plantar reflex. So Babinski sign positive, if you say it is the abnormal thing in the plant, when you are eliciting the plantar reflex, the abnormal is seen in the case of the corticospinal tract lesion or upper motor neuron lesion, where when you scratch the heel or the foot curving from the little toe to the great toe, the dorsiflexion of the foot, dorsiflexion of the great toe, dorsiflexion of the great toe, and dorsiflexion of the all the toes, and fanning out, all the toes will be fanned out like this. So all the toes will be fanned out like this. Dorsiflexion of the ankle, dorsiflexion of the great toe, dorsiflexion of all the toes with fan, with fanning out of the fingers. This is called the Babinski sign. This is called the Babinski positive. Pathologically seen in the case of the corticospinal tract lesion or upper motor neuron lesion. Normally also it is seen, Babinski positive seen normally below 1 year, that is infant. In infants, because still the peripheral tracts are getting still myelinated, so myelination is not complete yet, so still they are get to myelinated. In such cases you will see the Babinski is positive. In deep sleep it is seen Babinski is positive, and then in coma the Babinski sign is positive. Up to now we examined the bulk of the muscle in the motor neuron system examination. Bulk of the muscle is examined, tone of the muscle is examined, power or strength of the muscle is examined, reflexes we have examined. Next is the coordination. So coordination of the movements. So coordination of the movements means it is the smooth recruitment of the group of muscles so that a particular given task or movement is executed. So the group of muscles are recruited in a smooth way, in a coordinated way, so that a given discrete task, a particular task is performed. That is called as the coordination. So the coordination is the function of the cerebellum. So that is why otherwise can also be called as the cerebellar function test. So coordination is done in the upper limb and lower limb. So in the upper limb, the test which is performed is called as the finger nose test and finger finger test, where the subject with the outstretched hand, with the taking index finger, touches the tip of the nose alternately with the right hand and left hand. So we will demonstrate this. Finger is demonstrated with open eyes, then closed eyes. He is able to touch the with the finger, outstretched finger touching the tip of the nose. Next it can be done is the finger nose test. So the subject can keep the index finger, the examiner keeps the index finger, subject will alternately touch the finger and the tip of the nose. This is called as the finger nose test. Finger finger test and finger nose test here demonstrated for the coordination in the upper limb. Another test in the upper limb can be demonstrated, the dia-doco-kinesia. Dia, two, doco, hands, kinesia, movement. With both hands, you demonstrate the hand movement, that is called as the dia-doco-kinesia, where they will be alternately supinating and pronating in the forearm. Pedestra. So it is demonstrated in the forearm, like you are screwing a light in its holder. So like this supination, you can be demonstrated, or otherwise it can be demonstrated like this, alternating with the both hands like this, they can be demonstrated. This is called the dyadochrokinesia, and cerebellar disease, this is last, which is called the dysdyadochrokinesia, or unable to do, is called the adyadochrokinesia. And another best example in the upper limb, the coordination test is writing. So drawing circles or writing in the air. So subject is able to draw the circle exactly, that is the beginning and ending point is same, so they are touching that beginning point with the imaginary round, the hand. Next, in the lower limb, so the heel is brought to the knee, from the knee it is drawn over the shin till it reaches the down. This is called the heel knee test. This is a test for coordination in the lower limbs. Similarly, drawing circles can also be demonstrated in the separate drawing circles with foot in the air is another test for the coordination. Another best test for coordination in the lower limb is walking on the straight line. So walking on a straight line is another test for coordination for the cerebellum function in the lower limb. So this examine the coordination tests in the upper limb and in the lower limb. Next, in the motor system, next component to examine is the gait. Again, the gait. So particularly examine when they walk and turn around, you have to observe the turn around and coming back. So this is what you examine in the gait. Gait is important in that, so there are abnormal gaits, you all know, that is in the corticospinal tract lesion, you call it the spastic gait or circumduction gait. This gait is called the circumduction gait or spastic gait, because in the upper motor neuron lesion, in the upper limb flexors will be in a rigidity, lower limb extensors will be rigid, so they are not flexing. So if you are walking, you have to clear the ground. So to clear the ground, they are bringing the leg away and then bringing back towards the line, that is called as the circumduction. They are circumducting, and because of the spasticity, so that is called as the circumduction gait. Other gait, which demonstrated, is called the stamping gait, seen in the case of the sensory ataxia, dorsal column lesions, or the tapes dorsalis. So this is called the high stepping gait, seen in the case of foot drop, where the lateral peroneal nerve is damaged or cut. This is called the drunken gait or cerebellar, in the cerebellar lesion, is called the cerebellar ataxia, where the to maintain the balance, they are wide based, there is the foot are kept away like this, and they are like a drunken man, so they are trying to prevent the fall. And gait, seen in the Parkinsonism, because of the uniform rigidity, all the muscles are rigid. So to prevent the fall of the center of the gravity, so there is no movement of the associated movement of the hands. Uniform rigidity, short shuffling gait, so bent forward, that is called the festinant gait. So we have examined the motor system, the components. First you examine the bulk of the muscle, next you examine the tone of the muscle, next you examine the strength or power of the muscle. We demonstrated the reflexes, and then we demonstrated the coordination in the upper limb and lower limb, and we demonstrated the gait, normal gait and abnormal gait. And finally, we have to look for the any extra movements which you called as the involuntary movements. So all these movements which you have seen up to now, they are with purpose, they are demonstrated with the purpose. So if you see the patient is sitting, subject is sitting without any purpose, the purposeless movements, if they are seen, they are called as the involuntary movements. So involuntary movements they are called. So they can be localized or generalized. Localized, like in a muscle, you can see fibrations in the muscle, or fasciculation, for example, you will be seeing. So you will be seeing a contraction of the muscle around the eye, we say that. Or sometimes will be twitchings around the mouth. So these are called the fibrillation and fasciculations. Generalized involuntary movements, you can see sometimes the tremors, purposeless movements. So tremors, to and fro movements are seen involuntarily. So these tremors, again, physiologically also they can be seen in the old age, senile tremors they are called. In hyperthyroidism you can see the fine tremors, and in anxiety, when you are anger or anxiety, there will be tremors seen in your body. These are all physiologically seen. Pathologically, two types of tremors we used to explain. One is the resting type of tremor, other one is called the intentional tremor. Resting tremor, you see, the case of Parkinsonism, where it's called as the pill rolling. So the hands will be moving like this. This is called as the pill rolling movement, type of movement seen resting. When the patient is resting, you will observe the tremors, resting tremors. When he intended to do some work, they disappear. Well, the intentional tremor, in the cerebellar lesion, you will find the intentional tremors. These will be normal, no tremors are seen. You ask it to do some work, then the tremors appear. So you can differentiate both these tremors by giving, offering a glass of water. You keep a glass of water over the table, ask him to drink. Parkinsonism patient, he will be having tremors, but you ask him to drink, he will lift the glass without spilling a drop of water, he can drink. After keeping it there, again tremors will appear. Whereas the cerebellar lesion is normal, appears to be normal. You ask him to drink, when his hand approaches the glass, then the tremor starts, and he cannot drink. He spills all the water down, because that is called the intentional. So in a cerebellar lesion, he cannot run into the shock. When he, at the time he put a button into the shock, tremors appear, you cannot button the shut. These are called the intentional tremor seen in the cerebellar lesion, and resting tremor seen in the Parkinsonism. And other tremors are also types of involuntary movements are seen in the case of basal ganglion lesions, like chorea, where there is a dance like movement seen in the chorea, and atytosis, slow writhing type of movements are seen, or violent movements are seen called as the ballism. So these types of involuntary movements are seen in basal ganglion lesion, chorea, atytosis. Sometimes chorea atytosis combinedly present, and sometimes ballism, ballistic movements, violent dance like movements are seen. Sometimes they are seen in the whole body, sometimes they will be seen on the one side of body, called as the hemiballism. Yes. So today we examined the motor nervous system of a subject. So in physiology we will be examining a normal subject, so where you examine the bulk of the muscle. But pathologically, the bulk of muscle, you will see in the atrophy and hypertrophy. So atrophy seen in the case of the lower motor neuron lesion type of lesions, atrophy not seen in the case of upper motor neuron lesion type lesion, because the reflexes are present. So reflexes are present, so the muscle reflexively contract, so the nutrition is not lost, atrophy is not seen. But upper motor lesion of long duration, some amount of disuse atrophy may be seen, but grass atrophy will not be seen, unlike in the case of the poliomyelitis, where you have seen, if you are older generation, you might have seen. Nowadays the polio is almost eradicated. Now you are not able to see the polio patient. Earlier we used to see the polio patient where there will be grass difference between the bulk of muscle between the right and left limbs, or left leg and right leg. So very small leg on one side, huge leg, because he had to support, he is supporting whole body on the other leg only. So it has become hypertrophy. So in poliomyelitis you can see both atrophy in diseased leg and hypertrophy in the normal leg, like this. So this you can examine during the bulk of the muscle, you can diagnose upper motor and lower motor neuron depth of lesion, both you can be diagnosing. Similarly, tone of the muscle you examine, so normal tone in abnormal person. In abnormal you can see the hypotonia or hypertonia. Hypotonia, which you call the flaccid paralysis, again seen in the case of lower motor neuron type of paralysis. Hypertonia seen in the case of the upper motor neuron type of paralysis, or some anxiety, or some suppose like reinforcement, like you have seen the Gendra 6 maneuver, where the tension or tone will be increased. Next you examine the power of the muscle, again the power based on the grading. So you say you can diagnose the paralysis grade 0 and recovering grade 1, grade 2, grade 3, like that you can diagnose. Normal person, normal subject, grade 5. So you can diagnose the paralysis or paresis. So in this corticospinal tract lesion, if there is a slight weakness, you call it the paresis. Complete lesion, complete loss of function of the movement or motor activity, you call it the paralysis. One side you call it the hemiplegia, all the four limbs you call it the quadriplegia, and only two lower legs you call it the paraplegia. Like that you can diagnose the plegias, the paralysis, based on the strength of the muscle. Deciding your strength of the muscle, you can diagnose the plegias or the paresis. Next you examine the reflexes, again deep reflexes will be exaggerated in the upper motor neuron lesion. So upper motor neuron lesion, tone is increased, reflexes is exaggerated. Lower motor neuron lesion, hypotonia and reflex is absent. Deep reflexes are absent in the lower motor neuron lesion. But both these things, the reason, explanation is, in the reticular formation, we have the medullary reticular formation and pontine reticular formation, which control the gamma motor neuron discharge. So higher control over the gamma motor discharge. So the medullary is the inhibitory, and then the pontine is facilitatory. So pontine facilitatory is spontaneous, medullary inhibitory is dependent on the brain, basal ganglia and cerebellum, that is cerebrum, basal ganglia and cerebellum. These are the three negative influences. Medullary reticular formation are dependent on these three. So if there is any lesion in any area, cerebral lesion, negative is decreased, positive is because of the pontine reticular formation. Pontine is dominant. When one negative is decreased, positive becomes dominant, facilitatory becomes dominant. That is why there is a hypertonia, tone is increased in the muscles, similarly reflexes are exaggerated. So basal ganglia lesion, again the negativity is decreased, positive is increased, that is the facilitatory is increased, again the tone is increased. So the tone increase, it is called as spasticity in the case of the corticospinal tract lesion or cerebral lesion, and it is called as rigidity in the basal ganglia lesion, because again you can call it as the pyramidal or extra pyramidal. So pyramidal tract lesion produces the spasticity. Spasticity means, so any movement in our body is due to the contraction of the two types of muscle. One is called agonistic, other one is called the antagonistic. So agonist, both of the group of muscles facilitate a movement. Agonist because of its contraction facilitating movement, antagonist because of its relaxation facilitate a movement. For example, you are doing a flexion in the elbow, agonistic causing the contraction, biceps causing the contraction, producing the facilitation, that is the flexion. biceps is an antagonist because of its inhibition. Because of its inhibition, it is promoting the movement. That is why it is called agonist, antagonistic. There being extension, biceps becomes the agonist, biceps becomes the antagonist. So, in the case of spasticity, one group of muscles become hypertonic, other group of muscles become hypertonic. That is called as spasticity. In corticospinal tract lesion, flexors in the upper limb, extensors in the lower limb are hypertonic. That is why in the gait also you observe the circumduction gait in the corticospinal tract lesion. This is the reason behind hypertonia in the upper motor neuron lesion and exaggerated deep reflexes in the upper motor neuron lesion. Next, superficial reflexes, because you all know that it is a reflex arc, indicative of the reflex arc is important. So, in the superficial reflex, both upper motor neuron lesion and lower motor neuron lesion, in both lesions, the superficial reflexes are lost. Then you have seen the coordination in the cerebellar lesion. So, if the coordination is impossible or not possible, then you call it as the ataxia. Ataxia is again like in the sensory system, we are told ataxia, sensory ataxia also. We diagnose sensory ataxia by doing the Romberg sign. So, in the Romberg sign, we are able to diagnose the sensory ataxia. Here, it is the motor ataxia. Here, he cannot stand on a straight line with the close. Both foot close together. When the cerebellar lesion is there, he cannot stand like this. Whereas in the posterior column or sensory ataxia, he can stand with open eyes. Only with closed eyes, he cannot stand. Whereas in the cerebellar lesion, even with open eyes, he cannot stand like this. So, to maintain the balance, he will be standing like the white beast. You have seen the gait of the cerebellar lesion where he is walking with a white beast and like a drunken man in the cerebellar lesion. So, that is the coordination is lost. So, he cannot perform this hand, the alternating with both hands. This is called the dysdiadochokinesia or adiadochokinesia, loss of coordination. So, he cannot walk on the straight line. That is the test for coordination in the lower limb. So, gait again, different gaits we have demonstrated and the different diseases we can diagnose. Similarly, involuntary movements, they are absent normally. If they are present, they are indicative of the disease. With this, we examine, finally you have to report, give report. Based on these conclusions, you have to give report. If nothing is, everything is normal, you give a normal. On motor examination of the motor system, the subject is a normal. If some LMN lesion is seen, you can diagnose it as LMN lesion. Or if EMN is seen, EMN lesion, you can report. This is how we report the examination of the motor nervous system.